the cash cows are peaking, plenty of big names have joined the casualty ward and fantasy coaches are on the hunt for bargains. Here are my answers to the big NRL fantasy questions ahead of Round 8, which kicks off early with two blockbuster games on Anzac Day. Play NRL Fantasy presented by Youi. It's free, fun and totally addictive. Round 8 NRL team lists late mail. Round 8 thoughts on Scott Sorensen long term. Played the full 80 with Graham, Gallen out. Does he hold minutes when they return now that Luke Lewis is looking at more time on the sidelines? From Jason Barkle, Scott Sorensen had a great score in the back row for the Sharks last week and is already making fast money, but he's a risk. He is the bargain player set to get the biggest opportunity out of the injuries to Cronulla's forward pack, with Paul Gallen out for another month and Luke Lewis' calf also set to miss 4 weeks. But Graham returns this week to effectively replace Lewis, and the more experienced Jason Bukuya is also returning from via the bench, but Sorensen has kept his starting spot for now and at $294,000 is set for more price rises following his 69 in Round 7. Bukuya could bump Sorensen out of the starting side in the short term, or Lewis could come back from injury early, but while he is a bit of a gamble, if you're in the market for a sub-$300,000 cheapie who will definitely make money and probably score pretty well this round, Sorensen is probably your best bet. Is Ryan Madison a must-have, and thoughts on Sergis as an alternative once he's back? From George Bright, Madison has been a fantastic scorer this season with big scores boosted by tries followed by a 65-tackle bonanza for a score of 70 last week, but I still wouldn't quite put him in the must-have bracket. There are a lot of high-scoring second-rowers in fantasy and a few good halves, Sean Johnson, Daly Cherry Evans, etc., so you can get by without Madison in your side. He's obviously a good buy though. Sam Burgess is still a potential keeper down the track, especially now he's available in the front row or second row, but his suspensions are incredibly frustrating for those who have him in their side already. High Lone Scout, with Pierce out for the Knights, who do you think will pick up his points, Watson or Cogger? From Peter Mitchell, Pierce's pectoral injury that'll see him miss between 10 and 16 weeks is a big blow for Newcastle but presents an opportunity for a new half make their mark. Jack Cogger, $261,000, has the spot right now after being promoted ahead of Brock Lamb, $318,000, last week, with Connor Watson, $379,000, named at 5/8. Watson is a running 5/8 who doesn't do much kicking, so Cogger is likely to take on the bulk of the general play kicking while he holds his spot in the side, so there's real cash cow potential there. The problem is if Cogger or even Watson gets dropped, Lamb is waiting in the wings and is arguably the most dominant kicker of the three, so if he plays he's likely to be the best fantasy scorer of the trio. Upshot is I'd be waiting at least a week to see how Cogger and Watson perform this week. If Cogger struggles as a dominant organizing playmaker, Lamb could find his way back into the side soon, and you don't want to pick up a cheapie and then be forced to trade them out again. Do you think Urpana becoming fantasy relevant again this year or not worth the interest? Trevor Meggs, Jordan Rapana's current average of 33 is way down on previous years when he scored about 50 points a game, but that shouldn't come as a huge surprise as a winger who only has 2 tries in 7 matches this year. He could still be a gun if the Raiders put together a run of wins, but with the likes of James Tedesco, Kalen Ponga, Tom Turbojevic and Moses Mbye available, there are more reliable options out there. Your top 5 options for wing, fullback with money, not an issue. From Daniel, James Tedesco, Kalen Ponga, Tom Turbojevic, Moses Mbye and Dylan Edwards. Maybe Josh Duggan or Cody Walker ahead of Edwards. Is trading Sean Johnson to Madison wise or is it a burnt trade? Luke Southgate, Sean Johnson should be back next week so I'd hold him. He is actually in my team and I am holding him, good day legend. Need to get rid of Lodge for a cheapie so that I can pump cash into Dufta to upgrade to a solid keeper. Thinking Fatala Mariner, Cora Isau, Crichton or Guerra. Thoughts on possible cheapies and who to upgrade to. From Joel Daniel, this week's best cheapies apart from Sorensen are probably the same as last week's, Jaydn Swaw, Jack Gosiewski, Mitch Rain, with the riskier options being Jack Cogger and, now he's back in the halves, Bryce Cartwright. There are whispers Giant Broncos rookie Payne Haas could get a run off the bench as well, but I'd wait at least a week on him anyway. Debating offloading DCE for 2 keepers that don't play for Manly because can see them crashing hard with all the drama. Good or bad idea? From Asher Wilco Daily, Cherry Evans was a keeper last week and 1 bad score at the end of a bad week doesn't change that in my book. Manley's not in a great place right now, but DCE is still a dominant playmaker who will score well in base stats, kick meters, tackles, goals, and attacking stats most weeks. I'd be keeping him. Maga for Smith or Cook, I think Cook's better option, and DCE for Ben Hunt, good moves. From Ryan Viglianti, Andrew McCullough for Damian Cook is probably the best trade now. Cook's the only player to average more than 60 in fantasy this year, apart from Sorensen with his lone score of 69, but I reckon Cherry Evans will outscore Hunt over the course of the season, so I'd skip that trade. Thoughts on Ben Hunt as a long-term keeper? I've got him, but before his 90, he'd had 3 scores below 50 and was averaging just under that, which was starting to concern me. From George Bright, if you've got him, you certainly hold him and hope for more 90s, but if not, I wouldn't be taking the plunge just yet. The fact he shares playmaking duties with the equally impressive Gareth Widdup means neither of them are safe options as consistent 50 scorers. I'd prefer a dominant half like Sean Johnson and Daily Cherry Evans, or a dual position tackle machine like Ryan Matterson or Abisai Kwaraisau. Hey Scout! Thinking of trading Tavita Panjai Jr. out for Jazz Tavaga? He is a cheeky pod and has money to make, but is it worth a trade at this point of the game, or should I just roll with TPJ? Thanks from Anthony Petrie to Vita Panjai JNR. May get his scoring boost and more price rises in the next few weeks now that he's got the starting lock position at Brisbane, with Josh McGuire replacing the injured Andrew McCullough at hooker. I'd be holding him. Plus there's the risk that an 80-minute Simon Mannering could hurt the scoring potential of the other forwards at the Warriors, including Tavaga. What do you do when a cash cow has peaked, but you can't afford to upgrade to a gun? Do you trade for a minimum cost player, uses a trade but saves any value loss, or do you just go for the best you can afford? From Graham Locke, you don't need to trade a peak cash cow unless they are about to lose value, so it's better to strike at the right time rather than trading for a subpar scorer. Generally, the simplest way to make the most out of cash cows is to trade two at once, downgrading one to a cheap player, although this year with the reduced 21-man squads you want a cheap scorer, not just any bargain price player, and upgrading the other to a gun. If you can't afford a gun yet and your cash cow will likely hold his value another week, then wait for the right time to trade. Havila only played 40 minutes last week. Will this continue? Is it time to cash him in? Hold Sean Johnson? Best upgrade for Hiku. From Adam Watts Saliva, Havila's minutes have been up and down for Canberra this year, with a 40-minute stint against Souths after two 70-minute efforts. His break-even is still fairly low, but there's no guarantee he gets consistent minutes, so he can be cashed in the next few weeks. On the other questions, I'd hold Johnson and Hiku could be upgraded to Ewan Aitken, Latrell Mitchell or Josh Duggan. NRL Fantasy Teams Analysis, Round 8.